gifts are. Maybe we're still trying to figure that out. We just got to continue to seek that out. Like, it may take you guys a while. You guys may feel like you guys are just keep on digging a tunnel and you guys aren't like reaching the other side. Eventually, you guys will find that side. You just got to find the right people to lead you there. Maybe you guys have friends who are distracting. Maybe you guys have family members who aren't supportive of this, of our religion, of our relationship with Christ. They don't believe it. They think it's nonsense. You guys got to find mentors, people who are willing to serve, laying their lives down for Christ because they know how to serve. Now, we have youth leaders all around who are more than happy to be your guys' mentors. We've experienced life. We may not be super far ahead than you guys, but we have experienced life. We know a little bit about what could happen to us. Like, maybe we all have our different stories. We all have different pains. We all have gone through different experiences of life. We have the knowledge to give you guys to go through these tough times. Now, so if you guys want to be able to be servants, have a servant's heart, you guys got to drop the bickering. Like, we can't just keep bringing down one another. Now, I get it. Sometimes we do it with friends because we're close to them. But if we just keep bringing each other down, we can't bring each other up. So, what can we do in this time of giving to serve others? Like, maybe we just help out in the church. We can run a live stream camera on a Sunday morning. We can help out in kids' church. Now, I know there's a few students in here who do some of these things, like Nat. Nat, I know.
is up over you. Come on, stand up tonight. Let's do this thing right. Put your hands in the air like this. Come on. Here we go. I know you know the words. Let's sing together.
The faith awaits within the future. My dreams are small compared to yours. Why should I worry?
Come on, sing with me. Here we go.
And every little thing's gonna be alright. And every little thing's gonna be just right. Whether I can see it now, I know you will work it out for good. Everything will be alright.
Yet. How's everybody feeling? Dude, Christmas is around the corner. Am I the only one excited? Are you excited, John?
I'm excited.
John's excited. John has some announcements for you. Let's get it for John. Come on.
So what we got coming up in the next couple of weeks. First off, we're going to start out with a pastor's open house here on Sunday. It's going from 5 to 8. And who's running this? Derek's opening his. Denny's opening his house to y'all. We got Kenzie and Dylan, and we've got Kyle. Okay.
Mark, Tracy?
Mark, the kids pastor here, he's opening his house. I heard that Kyle's setting up an ice rink, so if you want to bring your skates out. Then next week, we've got our Christmas party here, and that's going to be an ugly sweater Christmas party. So be looking forward to seeing some ugly sweaters.
I'm already seeing some already. Just kidding.
Then after that, the 22nd, 29th. No youth? Really? Come on. Gotta have some youth. Nah. We can worship God anywhere that we are. We can praise the Lord no matter what building we're in. You know, I'll do it in the middle of Target. So before we go back into some worship, we've got our offering bucket set up here up front, that corner and that one over there. And gonna do a little bit of reading for you from Luke 21, verses 1 through 4. As Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. Truly, I tell you, he said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all that she had to live on. Now that speaks volumes to my heart, because through that you see that offering isn't about the number that we put in, but the heart that we have while putting that in. See, Jesus, he saw two coins getting dropped, but knew the heart was so much more. Knew the heart that was all that poor widow had, but she gave anyways. Now I'd like to pray for tonight's message and pray for the worship and the communion that we get to have this church community, see each other's faces. So thank you, Lord. Thank you for this day. We want to thank you for the church building that we have, but also the heart to pray outside, to learn, grow with you, God. Lord, we pray for tonight's message that the words are more than just the words being spoken from Nate, but just the words being laid on Nate's heart of you, Lord. And in your name we pray. Amen.
Would you guys stand with us and worship? Use me how you want to, God. Have your throne within my heart. I hear you call, and I am available. I say, yes, Lord.
Father, we can spend an eternity thanking you and giving thanks and responding to your love. There are not enough words to show our appreciation. There's not enough ways, not enough things that we can do to ever earn how great your love is for us. So tonight, all we choose to do is give you our hearts, our whole being, every part of who we are, and say once again, because of your goodness, I choose to make myself available. Available for things that may make me uncomfortable. Available for the call that you have on my life. Available so that you can be glorified. Help us to not forget that you first loved us. We give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. How are you guys doing tonight? You guys are probably doing a little bit better than I am if you were out there watching the game. My name is Nathan. For those of you who don't know me, I am a Heartland student here at the church. And so you may see me and my classmates running around doing different things for the youth group and whatnot. And last week, Thursday, Dylan came up to me and he said, "Hey, Nathan, just so you know, next Wednesday you might be speaking." And I've been in the program for, this is my third year now, and I've learned that when Dylan says, "Hey, you might be speaking," it means, "Hey, get ready, because you are 100% speaking." And so I asked him, "Well, what do you want me to speak on?" And all he told me was Christmas. And so I asked if there was a certain, like, direction he wanted me to go. Does he want me to talk about, like, Jesus? Does he want me to talk about gifts? What's he want to talk about? And he just said, "Nope, just talk about Christmas." And so I want to figure out what kind of room I'm talking to. So how many of you are the type that when it gets close to like 3 months away from Christmas, you are like, "I am ready for Christmas. I am going to decorate, like watch Christmas movies." If that's you, raise your hand. Okay, you guys are crazy. That's a little weird. If you are the type of person who's like, the minute Thanksgiving is over, then it's Christmas. So if that's you, raise your hand. All right, now this is me. If you are the person who's like, the week of Christmas, and maybe the week after, that's like Christmas season. If that's you, thank you. One, yes, okay. So that's when Christmas actually is. And so this year, I don't know why, but I have found myself like extremely excited for Christmas. And usually like I'm not. And like Christmas music is okay, like the week of Christmas. But otherwise, I don't really like Christmas music. And it was a week before Thanksgiving, and I sat down and watched all three of the Santa Claus movies. How many of you like those movies? Okay. In the same week, I caught myself humming along to Christmas songs. And I don't like Christmas songs, okay? So in honor of Christmas and Christmas songs, we're going to play a little game. So I need two people who would say that they are like diehard Christmas song fans and they know a bunch of Christmas songs. Tate? You? All right. We're going to play a little game. You guys can come down. Called Finish the Lyric Christmas Edition. Okay. All right, so here's what's going to happen. Okay, so here's what's going to happen. We're going to play a clip of a Christmas song. Okay, and then you guys are going, that first one to raise their hand gets to go first. You have to finish the line. If you get it wrong, the other person gets a chance to get it. We're going to play six songs. Whoever has the most at the end of the six wins, okay? All right, so if we can play the first one.
Santa Claus won't make me happy with a toy on Christmas Day.
Nope. That was it. So they're not all at the beginning, I guess. So we'll give it to you since you were technically right. Okay, so it could be at any part of the song, so you just have to listen, all right? Play the next one. I guess just give us a minute. No, you're finishing the, like...
Grandma got run over by a reindeer walking home from our house Christmas Eve. You can say there's no such thing as Santa,
but as for me and Grandpa, we believe.
Is he right? He is right. All right, 1-1. She's already ready. All right. You ready? Okay.
I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus will do. Don't want
a... I don't know the rest of that part.
Tate?
I don't want a toy or a rhinoceroses. I only want hippopotamuses. I don't know.
good guess.
No dinky tinker toy. I want a hippopotamus to play with.
All right, so it is 1-1. And then we'll play the next one. Tate, what do you want for Christmas?
I told my mom I wanted our piano tuned.
You guys ready? All right, here's the next one.
You know Dasher and Dancer and Prancer and Vixen.
Comet, Cupid, and Donner and Blitzen.
Comet and Cupid and Donner and Blitzen.
He is right. Well done, Tate. All right. No, we got more.
We got one more.
Or two more.
Another dog.
That's good. You ready? All right, here's the next one.
Year to save me from tears, I'll give it to someone special.
This year, to save me from tears.
All right, we have one more.
Hey, what's the score?
You're winning. I know that. All right, here's the last one.
Hey, jingity jing, it's Dominic the Donkey, jingity jing.
What's the next line?
I don't even know that.
I have no clue what that is.
The Italian Christmas donkey. La, la.
All right, you guys can go sit down. Thank you for playing. So like I was saying, last week Dylan told me I was speaking, and he told me that I had to speak on Christmas. And so I didn't know exactly what to speak on, and it got to the point where I needed to sit down, and I needed to just figure out what I was going to speak on. So I did what probably most of you do when you're doing homework. I sat down to do my work, and I started scrolling on Instagram. And I was scrolling on Instagram, and I went and refreshed my page, And all of a sudden, all these stories started popping up of something called Spotify Wrapped. How many of you use Spotify? And how many of you know what Spotify Wrapped is? So what it does is it tells you who your top five songs are and your top five artists are for the year. And so it got me thinking about, if that was our life, if our life was unwrapped, what would be the top five things in our life? And so tonight, I'm going to look at the book of Matthew, at the life of Jesus, and we're going to get five things that I believe can help us to make sure that God is on that list. So if you have your Bible, you can turn to Matthew chapter 6, or I'm pretty sure it's going to be on the screen, and we'll start at verse 5. And so this is Jesus teaching us in this passage, and it says, "And when you pray, do not be like hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. When you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." So the first thing on the top five things I think we can do to make sure God is a priority in our life is prayer. Prayer is really important in our life because it's what connects us with God. It gives us direct access to have a conversation with God. And see, verse 6 tells us that we are to go into our room, close the door, and pray. And in my life, I have found that the best prayers and the time I feel closest with God is when it's just me and him behind closed doors. See, a lot of us, we think that the only time we can connect with God is when we're at church or when other people are around or when somebody's giving us a message. But and the fact is that you can find him in any moment and you can find him anywhere you're at. For those of you who don't know, my dad is a pastor, and he likes to share a story on Sundays about my grandma. And my grandma is what we'd call like a woman of God, and she kind of had to be. She had 11 kids, she worked a full-time job, and she ran a farm, so she kind of had to be a woman of God. And in their house when he was growing up, there was only one room that had a lock on it, and it was the bathroom. And so my dad said they'd be walking around the house looking for my grandma, and they couldn't find her, so they'd go out to the barn. They couldn't find her out there. And so they'd go to the bathroom door, and they'd put their ear on the door, and they could hear my grandma in there praying in the spirit, getting in the word of God, and just finding her alone time with God. And see, when I said a prayer closet, what I mean is that place where you can go to find the presence of God. It can be different for many different people. For me, it's playing worship music in my truck and driving around and getting close to God. For some, it could be in a boat. Some, it could be in a hunting stand. You really just have to find that spot for you. And it also tells us in these verses that to not keep babbling on, because God knows our prayers. A lot of us, we kind of fear praying because we don't know what to say, or we think we're going to say the wrong thing. But the fact is, God knows your heart. God knows where you're coming from. And so it doesn't matter what you say. You just have to be vulnerable and open with God. The second thing out of the five that I think can get us closer to God is fasting. In Matthew chapter 6, starting at 16, it says, "When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show others they are fasting. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to others that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you." So after I read these verses, I went down to the footnotes in my Bible. And if you don't know what footnotes are, is when you have a study Bible, on the bottom of the page, it breaks down what the verses are telling you. So if you ever read something that's a little confusing, you can go there, and sometimes they'll give you insight on the verse. And I went down there, and I read about fasting. And it says, "Fasting, going without food in order to spend time in prayer, is noble and difficult. It gives us time to pray, teaches self-discipline, reminds us that we can live with a lot less, and helps us to appreciate God's gift." See, what fasting is fasting is staying away from a food or something that's taking up your time and filling that void with God. And so it's physically emptying yourself and then spiritually filling yourself. And we learn from this verse that we are to do it in private. We're not supposed to boast about it, or you don't need to go tell 100 people that you're going to be fasting. It's something that's just between you and God. And so you can fast many different things. You can fast food. You can fast Instagram. You can fast any type of social media. Anything that's taking up your time, you can put away, and you can dedicate time that you would spend during that to God. The third thing that I think we can do to make sure God is a priority in life is reaching the lost. We're going to read Matthew 28, 19 through 20. It says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." And you may be wondering how spreading the gospel or reaching the lost can improve your relationship with God. But if I was to ask you what your favorite movie is, you'd probably be able to tell me a bunch of the lines and a bunch of the stuff that happens during the movie. But if you've never seen the movie, you're not going to be able to tell me about it, right? You have to watch the movie to be able to tell others about it. It's the same thing when you're trying to reach the lost. In order to tell people, you need to learn it for yourself. And so it's just reaching the lost is also going to help grow you. And in this background of the story that we just read, Jesus had died at this point. He had been crucified and he had risen. And he was talking to his disciples, and he was giving them what we call the Great Commission. And it's to go out into the world and to share the gospel and to make disciples. And a lot of times we can get kind of scared of that, you know. It's kind of hard to share your faith in front of your friends or your family. But I once watched a video, and this guy was speaking about what the best day of his life is going to be. And he said the best day of his life is going to be when he's going up in the air to heaven. But he said the worst part about that day is when he turns around and he sees all the people behind him asking him why. Why didn't he share? It's when he sees his friends and they ask, why didn't you tell me who this God was? Why didn't you tell me that there was more to life than what I was living? See, we need to share the joy that God gives us so that others can have it too. The fourth thing that I think we can do to get closer to God is worship. In chapter 19, starting at 16, it says, this is Jesus speaking to a young rich man. It says, "Just then a man came up to Jesus and asked, 'Teacher, what good thing must I do to get eternal life?' 'Why do you ask me about what is good?' Jesus replied. 'There's only one who is good. If you want to enter life, keep the commandments.' 'Which ones?' he inquired. Jesus replied, 'You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. Honor your father and mother, and love your neighbor as yourself.' 'All these I have kept,' the young man said. 'What do I still lack?' Jesus answered, 'If you want to be perfect, go sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me.' When the young man heard this, he went away sad because he had great wealth. Then Jesus said to his disciples, 'Truly I tell you, it is hard for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God.'" Now, you may be wondering how these verses about somebody who has a lot of money has to do with worship. But you see, what you worship can be more than just God. It can be more than anything. It's what you invest your time in. What is your number one priority? And for this young man, his number one priority was his wealth. So what is something that you find yourself worshiping today? Is it a relationship? Is it that guy or that girl? Is it maybe drugs, or maybe an alcohol, or maybe it's even a thought like depression or suicide? Maybe you spend so much time focusing on those things that you forget that you need to worship the one, you need to worship God. See, the minute that we start redirecting our worship on God and our focus on God is the minute that he can start transforming our lives. And so you may ask, how do you change what you worship? See, what you worship can be your thoughts, your actions. Those are all things that can show who you worship. And so the minute you change your thoughts and your actions towards God is the minute that you can really start worshiping God. The fifth thing that I think we can do to get closer to God is devotions. Matthew 26, starting at verse 36. If I could find find it. So this is Jesus speaking, and this is Jesus' story, and it says, "Then Jesus went to his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, 'Sit here while I go over there and pray.' He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he asked them, 'My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me.' Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, 'My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will.' Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. 'Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?' he asked Peter. 'Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.'" So what devotions is when you take time in your day and you make priority in your day to get in the presence of God, to worship, and to read your Bible. See, Jesus was taking time out of his day to go get into the presence of God. And he brought with the disciples with him, and they fell asleep in the story. And he asked them, "Why couldn't you just spend 1 hour with me?" And you see, there's a lot of power in even just 1 hour in the presence of God. Daily devotions is what opens you up to hear from God. It's what helps us to grow in a relationship, and it's what helps us to not fall into temptation. If you think about any relationship, it revolves around communication. And communication is a two-way street. And when we pray, we are communicating to God. And the best way to hear God communicate back is getting in his word. And that is what you can do during your devotions. So to wrap this up, I just want to ask you a question. What are the top 5 priorities in your life? Because when you think about the Spotify Wrapped, it gives you 5 songs and 5 artists that you spend the most time with. Those are your priorities over other songs. And so if you were to unwrap your life, what would your priorities be? A lot of us get comfortable with that list. You know, maybe God's not on that list. And, you know, maybe it's a little difficult to get God on that list. And maybe you don't even want God to go farther up the list. You know, maybe you're fine with God sticking around number 3 or number 4 on that list. And you just don't want to put him above that relationship. Or you don't want to put him above maybe that image that you're trying to uphold. But the minute that you let God go to number 1 on that list is the minute that you see your life go to the fullness that God has for it. And the way we do that is through these 5 things. It's getting in God's word. It's spending time with him. It's being in his presence. So I challenge you that this week, find different ways that you can get in God's presence. Find different ways that you can set aside time. Maybe that is fasting. Maybe that's just reading your Bible every day. Whatever it is. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to go into time of life groups. So, and when we go into life groups, all the guys are going to meet over here, and then we'll split you up when we get over there. So let's pray. Lord, I thank you for today. I thank you for who you are, and I thank you for what you're doing in our lives. Lord, I pray that you would take over the list of the top 5 priorities in our life, Lord, that we would just devote those 5 things to you, Heavenly Father. I pray that you would speak to us throughout the week, and that we'd have a good week. In Jesus' name, amen.